Everyone to a presentation on race, ethnicity, and dementia. Dr. Gwen Yeo, who is Director Emerita of the Stanford Geriatric Education Center, and I, Kala Mehta, had the pleasure and opportunity to give this talk once before in 2009. I will be presenting the talk today with a few updated slides. The reasons that we are re-recording this webinar is because we had some technical difficulties on the first recording, and we wanted to make sure that it was available for viewers. So again, this was a talk that was given in 2009, but has been somewhat updated and will be given today on January 17, 2011. And welcome to the webinar. This webinar will be in a few parts. The overview is that there will go over a bit of background regarding dementia, specifically as it relates to the growth. We'll talk about some incidence and prevalence of dementia in diverse communities. We'll discuss why are some of these differences found. Next, we'll talk about what diverse dementia patients and their families say and what they consider important. And lastly, we'll talk about some treatment and survival differences. So, by way of background. So, many of you in the audience already know the personal cost of dementia and know that dementia is on the rise. You see that in your clinic populations. You see that through your friends and relatives. And you can see it with the aging of the U.S. and the worldwide population. But let's talk about the actual cost. So the total cost of dementia worldwide in 2010 is $604 billion. That is astronomical. And 70% of that global cost is right here in Northern America and Western Europe. In addition to that, the cost of caring for an older adult with Alzheimer's disease is at least $172 billion. So 604 plus 172 billion. And just to put, those are astronomical dollar values. Just to put that into perspective, figure one, which is from the World Alzheimer's Report, shows that that cost of dementia is actually higher than the total revenue of, or total annual revenue of Walmart or ExxonMobil, two very large companies in the United States. And so why does that happen? Why does that occur? Well, people everywhere are living longer. People here in the United States, you can see the average life expectancy in 1950 was just under 70, and now it is projected in 2050 to be over 80, almost 85. Those trends are happening in countries across the world, in Japan, in Germany, in Brazil, and in the most populous countries of China and India. What does this mean when there's great population boom? Is that we're going to see even more dementia. So, and where are we going to see that dementia? It's going to be in low and middle income countries. The projected amount of dementia in high-income countries is steadily rising, but the big booms are in low- and middle-income countries where there's people aging and better medical care, so they're living longer and also, living long enough to have dementia. So even there's great diversity within the United States. There's diversity in the states themselves in terms of how Alzheimer's is impacting these states. Some states, like those in New England and in the middle of the country, are having a rate of Alzheimer's increasing from 0 to 24%. That's pretty reasonable. But these countries here in the Pacific Northwest and in Alaska are raising Alzheimer's rates by 90 and 120%. That means that their numbers of people with dementia are doubling. In essence, that's huge. And this is from 2000 to 2025. So just as this is happening in the United States, diversity or being belonging to a minority or ethnic race minority group is also on the rise. In 2010, 20% of the older adult population, that is people 65 years and older, are of minority race ethnicity. That means that they self-report that they are Latino, Asian, or African American, or of other race. By 2050, these colored parts of the pie are at 42%. That means that the race ethnic makeup is almost double. And the older adult population that happens to be of a minority race ethnicity is growing. Of those groups, the fastest changes are in the Latino group and the Asian group. And right here at home in California, we have a lot of ethnic diversity, and that is reflected in our older adult population. Our older adults are Asian, African American, and Latino, and also of other race ethnic minorities. And almost 40% of our older adults here in California are from a minority population. In fact, you could say that the diversity in California in 2010 is what the US diversity profile is going to be in 2050. So we are foreshadowing the nation in terms of our demographic makeup. Putting all this information together, the fact that people are aging, the fact that dementia is on the rise, and the fact that the makeup of the older adult population is changing to become more ethnically diverse, we would posit that dementia is now becoming a condition of diverse populations. That's true in the United States and also worldwide. And now I'm going to sort of delve even a little bit deeper into race and ethnic diversity. Many of us use these key terms, and I myself have used these key terms in the talk so far. What does it really mean to be of a minority race or ethnicity? Many people adhere to the definitions given to us by the US Census, where they build categories of self-report, such as, are you of Hispanic origin, yes or no, and do you belong to a specific race, African American, Asian, white? And these questions are asked separately. What we've done here is we've tried to divide those into mutually exclusive categories. That is, somebody who is Latino, who says that they are of Hispanic ethnicity of any race, then those who are African American, non-Latino, Asian, not Latino, white, not Latino, and those of other race ethnic groups. But I think what's really important to recognize when we study diverse ethnic groups is that each category, each of these really broad categories, for example, Latino, may be people who come from a lot of different countries of origin. For example, somebody who's Latino could be from Latin America, from South America, from a Caribbean country, from Mexico. And so we have to really keep in our minds that these are broad categories, but within them there is even a very large amount of diversity. So let me go to some incidence and prevalence data, keeping that in mind. Many of the figures that I'll quote are from the Health and Retirement Study. This was a large population-based survey of people 50 years and older who were assessed biennially from 1992 forward and to date. They were studied regarding their health and their wealth, particularly the transitions that it takes from being a person who is working in the workforce to then becoming retired and how that impacts a person's health. They used race ethnicity grouping based on self-report, as I was describing earlier, and they talked about cognitive impairment as defined using standardized cognitive testing developed for the HRS. And using those data, when we look at African American and Latino older adults, we see that African American and Latino older adults have 2 to 3 times higher prevalence of cognitive impairment compared to white older adults in the U.S. using these U.S. representative data. And this pattern is true across the younger age groups, the younger old, the middle old, and the oldest old. Similarly, using separate data where they actually categorize people based on their diagnosis of Alzheimer's disease or dementia, African American and Caribbean older adults have a 2 to 3 times higher prevalence of Alzheimer's disease and dementia. Now, this is a different study. This is in older adults in the Washington Heights area in Manhattan. So this is another study that looked at 3 race ethnic groups, but largely had sort of the same findings as the U.S. national study. So it's corroborative information to suggest that African American and Latino adults have higher rates of both cognitive impairment and Alzheimer's disease. But there is heterogeneity. So here we have data from the SALSA, the Sacramento Area Longitudinal Study on Aging. Now this study was kind of different because it studied people of Mexican American heritage and not the Caribbean American heritage predominantly studied in the New York area. And they actually found rates of Alzheimer's disease and dementia that were very similar to the white rates of the previous slide. So there's some heterogeneity even within the Latino group. One study suggests that Caribbean Latinos have higher rates. Another study suggests that Mexican American older adults, by and large, have similar rates. So what could be going on here? Well, what could you do to really tease apart how these populations are being impacted? Well, here we have to sort of digress into a little lesson on epidemiology. So what's the difference between prevalence and incidence? So prevalence is the number of dementia cases in a defined population at a designated time. So if you think about it, it's like a big swimming pool. If you have a big swimming pool, it's all the people who are in the swimming pool swimming at a particular time, like a snapshot. Incidence is the number of new cases in a defined population in a designated time interval. That means, who are all the people getting into the pool? And what's great about incidence is when you're measuring who's getting into the pool, as you can imagine, you take out the effect of the people who stay in the pool a really long time or people who exit the pool really quickly. You're really sort of measuring apples to apples. So epidemiologists really like this incidence rate because it helps us to define what's actually going on with the population. So here we have 4 different studies where we're just comparing head-to-head the incidence, that is those new cases of disease for African-American versus non-Latino white older adults. And the 4 studies are the Chicago Health and Aging Project, the Cardiovascular Health Study, the Indianapolis Ibadan Study, and the Northern Manhattan Study. And if you walk down the bars, you'll see that contrasting the darker bars to the lighter bars, African American older adults have higher Alzheimer's disease incidence compared to white older adults in every single study listed. Okay. Similarly, another way that we could look at things to try to figure out whether these effects are real is to look at cross-cultural studies. Now, what cross-cultural studies do is they study the same race ethnic group, but they do it in different countries. So, for example, the very famous Indianapolis Ibadan study studied African American older adults living in and around Indianapolis, Indiana, and they also studied Yoruba Nigerians who were living relatively near the metropolitan area of Ibadan. And what they found was that African Americans living in Indianapolis had higher rates of Alzheimer's disease incidence, remember again, those are the number of new cases compared to those, the Yoruba. Similarly, we have data from the Honolulu Asia Aging Study, which is another very famous study of Japanese men, where they studied Japanese men living in Japan and Japanese American men living in Hawaii, in Honolulu. And here too, we see that the Japanese American men have higher incidence rates compared to the Japanese men living in Japan. So how do I encapsulate these race and ethnic differences? So it seems that for African Americans, it seems that the data are pretty clear that there's an increased prevalence and incidence of Alzheimer's disease in African American groups compared to non-Latino whites. For Latinos, as I showed and pointed out earlier, it's the jury's still out. We don't exactly know. It seems that Caribbean Americans have been shown to have increased prevalence, and the Washington Heights study also has some data on increased incidence for that group. But other studies that have really good data on Mexican Americans suggest that maybe they're similar prevalence. So maybe it is just that for Latinos, there's different things going on for subpopulations. For Japanese Americans, we know that there are increased rates of Alzheimer's disease here for Japanese Americans residing in the U.S. or in Honolulu compared to Japanese residing in Japan. And then there's a whole host of other race ethnic groups, other Asian subgroups, like those who are coming from China or those who are coming from India, and American Indian populations, where we just don't have any data or very, very little data on the prevalence and incidence of Alzheimer's disease. What we do have is some unique case reports or case series studies, but less on true prevalence and incidence to know whether this disease is affecting them more. So now we wanted to go into, well, why are some of these differences found? I think one of the things that comes to mind and is probably the first sort of set of factors that have been studied is socioeconomic factors, which may underlie race-ethnic differences. So this is a study that I and my colleagues at UCSF conducted that was published in JAG, where we measured cognitive function test score differences in older adults who were African American and white. And what was unique about this study is that all the older adults who participated were very well functioning. So they couldn't have any mobility difficulties. They were really like high functioning older adults. Yet what we saw was a very big difference on their performance on the mini mental state exam, which is a global cognitive function test, wherein at the beginning, we saw a 7-point difference between African Americans and whites. These older adults were on average about 72 years old and were almost 50% women versus men. So we wanted to see if we could do some statistical adjustments. Could we take away that race-ethnic difference? Is the whole race-ethnic difference that we see really made up of other things? Well, what we found was we took demographic factors like age and gender to see if we controlled for that, does that take away the race-ethnic difference? And it really didn't. Then we took some psychosocial factors like how the older adults performed on depression tests. Did that make a difference between African American and white older adults? Well, that didn't really seem to make much of a difference. Then we adjusted for things like comorbidity, like heart disease, lung disease, that sort of stuff. And that actually changed it a little bit. Not a whole lot, but it did change it a little bit. But then we took the really big factor, and that was educational level and literacy. So how did the older adult, what was their baseline educational level, and what was their ability to take a literacy test in older adulthood. And this is a test about regarding health literacy. And we found that that actually had the biggest impact on the difference in scores between African Americans and whites, is the education, their educational background and their literacy. So when we actually adjusted for all the factors put together, we reduced a 7-point gap to a 1-point gap. And so I think that what that tells us is that socioeconomic factors, really education, literacy, these things that impact early learning are very important to take into account. So how do, you know, neurologists and those who are performing at these high-level memory clinics, university-affiliated memory clinics, how do they assess patients? Well, they use an industry standard of a very, very extensive exam, a medical exam, a neurological exam, a psychiatric exam, a neuropsychological exam, lab values, MRI scans, and then they get together in a, as part of this very unique and ideal multidisciplinary team and review all the cases, taking into account their prior education and language background to really figure out whether this patient has dementia. But you know, that's a situation that's very unique to only a handful of patients who actually make it to those tertiary centers. Handfuls, scores and scores of patients don't make it to those very specialized centers. Most people are seen in primary care. So what do you do for them? Many people say, you know, I don't know if I should use a screen. I think many general practitioners, family practitioners, or primary care physicians use the mini mental state exam, but they themselves have discovered that people of different races and ethnicities, even if the instrument is translated, it may have different meaning to different people. Many primary care physicians or people out in the community have said, well, we can't use the line no ifs, ands, or buts with our Chinese patients because to them that sentence doesn't make any sense. Or to the Latino patients, that doesn't make any sense. So I think that we have to be aware that sometimes these screens that we commonly use to diagnose patients may act differently in different race ethnic groups. We have to be cautious about that. So what can you really do? I think the impact of not understanding how these screens work is that it could really decrease the specificity of the cognitive measure. Well, what does that mean? That means that you will have a whole lot more false positives by administering these tests. And that could be a good thing or it could be a bad thing, actually. And decreased specificity can sometimes lead to misdiagnosis of cognitive impairment. And the other thing that's really not well known is whether there are race-ethnic differences in specific cognitive domains. So I think, you know, we have to be cautious when applying standard cognitive batteries to people of diverse language and ethnic backgrounds. So how best can we use these screening tests? I think the next set of data will really help us with that. So one way to use the test is to look at cognitive decline over time. It's basically saying that what you're doing with patients when you follow them up, if you have a suspicion and you follow them up over time, that what you're doing is correct. You use each patient as their own control. So for example, here's some data from the MAP or MARS study collected in the Chicago area by a colleague of mine, Lisa Barnes, and this slide is courtesy of her, wherein this is the overall cognitive function test change on a series of, like a very extensive neuropsychological battery in both white participants and African-American participants. And what you see is that same score differential or same gap at the beginning, just like you saw in the prior study that I talked about that had a gap in scores. But what you do also see is that the slopes are the same. And so this gives you a lot of confidence in using each individual as their own control. You measure them once, then you measure them 6 months down the line to see if they've changed. Interestingly enough, this is data from another group at Duke, and they used the same technique where they measured older adults over time on a different cognitive instrument, the short portable mental status score. And they saw the same pattern. Again, baseline, African Americans had a lower score than whites at the static measurement, but if you look at the slopes, they're the same. And then we looked at the same data in three groups, in white, then non-Hispanic white, Latino, and African American. And again, we see the same score differential at baseline, but the story is the same, that their slopes over time are the same. And so that means that for Latino patients, for African American patients, if you have a standard cognitive measure, in this case it's a modified TICS, which is a telephone interview for cognitive status, then you can use each person as their own control for follow-up purposes. I always get this question, what do you do if you only have a few minutes? You've got 1 or 2 minutes to really, you know, assess somebody, and you want to do it in the most culture fair, the least biased way possible. Well, I talked to a lot of my colleagues in neuropsychology, and I think that what they recommend is to really do the immediate and delayed word recall. This is a test of memory, short-term memory, and it really seems to be relatively good at sorting out people who have delayed memory recall, and that is highly predictive of being predisposed to Alzheimer's. So that's one. And another one that's really simple that people can do from various culture is animal naming. People can do it. It's really quick. It's informative. Tell me all the animals that start with the letter S. It's, you know, or tell me a list of, you know, it's pretty easy to do, and people can respond to it. It's quick. And if they can't do it, they cannot function, then that's an indicator of potential follow-up. So what's another set of factors that could be playing into race-ethnic differences? I think vascular risk factors are very common in race-ethnic minority populations and have been studied a lot in terms of their impact. Here we see the same health and retirement study data, wherein we see that the African-American and Latino older adults have higher rates of blood pressure and diabetes, and particularly so if they have cognitive impairment. In addition, the link between diabetes and Alzheimer's is very important for minority adults. People with midlife diabetes are known to have 2 times the risk of dementia when they're older. Diabetes is a risk factor for heart disease and renal failure, and both of those are risk factors for Alzheimer's disease, so it's duplicative. And then we know from many studies that diabetes is higher, especially in the African American and Latino and some Asian subgroup population. So then I'm going to switch gears. So I think what we're saying is, you know, pay attention to how you assess your race, ethnic minority, older adult when patients come in the door. Make sure that if you're suspicious of memory impairment or problem, be sure to follow them up. If you only have a few minutes, use some of these more culture fair items. And then, you know, if you're really looking for underlying problems or underlying things, the things that are actionable are really these vascular differences. Can you intervene upon their diabetes? Can you intervene upon their heart disease to really make an impact on their cognition later on down the road? So now we're going to go to some studies that really ask the patient and their families what's important. And so this is a study I conducted with a fellow regarding risk perception. And risk perception really asked the person or the participant to forecast how they feel they have a chance of developing Alzheimer's in the next 10 years. And so we asked the respondents to estimate their percent chance that they themselves would develop Alzheimer's in the next 10 years. And African Americans had a lower perceived risk than non-Latino whites. And I think that that's, you know, has implications beyond the risk perception study, because perhaps if African Americans, older adults, feel that they have a lower perceived risk, they may engage in different behaviors, or they may have different ideas about when to follow up on a potential memory impairment. Another study done by Peggy Dilworth at Anderson looked at sort of an in-depth qualitative review of 22 families. 7 of these families were white, 10 of these families were African American, and 5 of these families were American Indian. And what she found in this review, she took them through the process of memory impairment and through the process of attaining a diagnosis of Alzheimer's disease. And in each of the cases, she saw that ethnic minority groups often sought a diagnosis much later than their white counterparts, and that they had, you know, basically very different experiences with the medical system. So I think that's also really important to take into account. Okay, now I'm going to talk about treatment and survival differences, which are for people who already have a diagnosis of Alzheimer's. These are some data that we wrote up that were published in Neurology regarding acetylcholinesterase inhibitors. These are drugs that are given to patients with Alzheimer's disease that stave off the decline. They don't change the course of the disease, they just slow it from happening. And so we looked at patients who were seen at the 10 Alzheimer's disease research centers here in California, and we found that compared to all white patients, people of African American, Latino, and Asian race ethnicity had lower reports of acetylcholinesterase inhibitor use, such that they reported use about 25% less than their white counterparts. And this was after adjustment for age, education, sex, where they lived, whether they had insurance, and their severity of disease. So I think what we're seeing here is a real difference in race ethnicity in terms of their use or their report of use of a medication. Now, we don't really know why. Is this because of patient preference? Is this because because they were not offered this treatment? We don't have the exact idea of why they had these differences, but what we can say is that they did have a difference. Another really important sort of confirmatory piece of work is that African American and Latina older adults in the U.S., so this is from U.S. representative data, show lower rates of nursing home placement. So, and this is, again, adjusted for a whole host of factors that would impact the severity of their disease. And so what does that mean? That means that African American and Latina older adults who have significant cognitive decline are being taken care of in their homes by most probably their own family members. And that's very, very important to keep in mind. Not only that, but in addition to the fact that they're being cared for at home, African American and Latino older adults seem to have longer survival compared to white older adults with a diagnosis of Alzheimer's disease. And again, here, we tried to take away the race-ethnic difference by adjusting for many factors. But truly, there was a true race-ethnic difference in terms of the length of survival. So maybe because African American and Latino older adults are being cared for more often in their home, and because they're engaging in different decisions about their care in those years that they have the Alzheimer's disease, they are surviving longer than their white counterparts. The same pattern is borne out if we move the trajectory up and we don't look at people with confirmed diagnoses, but we look at people with significant cognitive declines. They also live longer. So it's just another corollary point that, you know, people with significant cognitive decline but who may not have had a diagnosis, they too are living longer. African American and Latino older adults with those significant cognitive decline live longer than their white counterparts. So really, you know, what is the summary of all of this work on race, ethnicity, and dementia? At the individual level, for minority older adults, this really means that they have higher rates of Alzheimer's disease and dementia, that often their symptoms are recognized later, they have lower medication use, they're less often placed in a nursing home, and they have longer survival. So this means that the families who are taking care of Latino and African American older adults have an extremely high burden. They're bearing the cost or sort of the societal or personal cost of the disease by taking care of their older adults in their home. And really at the population level, this means that you know, we have to keep in mind that the race ethnic diversity is growing in the U.S. older adult population with dementia, especially when we're serving people from many different cultures, that the incidence and prevalence of dementia is high in some groups, and that the data are really strongest for the African American white difference, that socioeconomic and vascular risk factors may be causes of these group differences. So for those things that are actionable, we have to keep in mind to have really good care for diabetes, for heart disease, so that we stave off getting the, you know, for those groups that have higher rates of those things, we have to be really vigilant and keep on top of it. And for African American, Latino older adults with cognitive impairment and dementia, they may live longer with the disease, probably as a result of more caregiving or differential caregiving at home. I think I could not have put this talk together without a whole host of people at UCSF, at Stanford, at the CADC, MAP and MARS, which is in Chicago, the HRS, which is in Michigan, Columbia, SALSA, data from Mary Hahn. So we, you know, this is a culmination of data from many, many different places. And I'm very thankful to Stanford and the Stanford Geriatric Education Center, which has done incredible work with patients and their families to really bring caregiving to communities that bring resources to caregivers in communities such as the Vietnamese population and the Chinese population and the Asian Indian population and Latino population. They have done so much good work. I would very much advise people who are interested in ethnogeriatrics to go to the SGEC website and avail of the resources there. I think I want to leave you with this last slide, which is a picture of dementia and diversity. We may have a conception in our mind of what dementia patients look like, and here is a capture of what dementia patients look like across the world. They have unique colors and faces and are often happy and well cared for by their family members. So thank you.